Thank you to Connie and Maria for everybody teeing up what I'm going to talk about now. So both of them mentioned that there are lots of opportunities in the transition to a low-carbon world. And many of those are opportunities that people in Alberta are very well suited to delivering. So I'm going to spend a bit of time talking about the technologies that are an essential part of delivering a low-carbon future. And in fact, technologies that are very essential to helping Alberta meet those challenging climate change goals that are in place that Connie described earlier. There are two names on the presentation. That's because one of my colleagues at Imperial, Dr. Tamara Knapp, produced the majority of this presentation. And so I wanted to give her credit for that. Okay, so to achieve our 2-degree goal globally, we can think about this as having a finite carbon budget, or a greenhouse gas budget. It's here in carbon dioxide equivalents. And that's the scale of the budget that we have there. That's great. That looks like quite a lot in terms of gigatons of carbon dioxide. But actually, it turns out that we've used it up quite quickly. So that's that you can see the dark blue is how much we have left, right? So that's how much we had available up until 1988. And then a few years later, when the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change was put into place. And then a few years later, when the Kyoto Protocol was set. It was set, but it only came into effect several years later in 2005. We had a failed climate change summit in 2009, all the time rapidly using up our limited carbon budget. In 2015, we had this phenomenal climate change agreement, ambitious and so on, but we've not got much of our budget left, actually, it turns out. And this is what the trajectory looks up like to using it all up. That's not very long. If you can look below the lines there, you can see that that line ends somewhere around 2030. So that's the kind of urgency that we're talking about if we're really serious about staying within a 2-degree only temperature rise over pre-industrial times. So what do we need to do? That line shows a leveling off of emissions. That would help, but actually, at some point, we're still putting greenhouse gas emissions into the atmosphere, which will continue to lead to a temperature rise. So in fact, we need to do that. So it's a challenge. So how do we get from here? Now, some of those pictures look more like, that looks more like a house in the UK. That's because that is a picture of a house in the UK. But basically, how do we get from here? So that's a picture of what we think transportation looks like now, what you might not think a house looks like, but I think a house looks like that. In fact, that kind of house is really drafty and uncomfortable and cold the entire year round. So it needs some better insulation and so on, so we could learn a bit from some of the housing you have here. And that's what we think about in terms of industry, right? So you might recognize those pictures. We want to go from there, well, from here, to there. Those pictures look very nice, right? You got a kind of a different kind of car, a much better insulated, perhaps even passive house, and some innovative approaches to industrial technology and power production. So how do we do that if you look at the urgency that I just created? There are kind of three categories of technologies that I want you to consider. First of all, there are technologies that are already established, but their rollout is really hampered by a lot of barriers. And a great example of that is energy efficiency improvement. That speaks to what Connie said, which is about producing new business models as a solution. The second type of technologies are technologies that are showing really positive trends. So they're in development, and we can see lots of reasons why they actually might roll out quite rapidly. And the third are technologies that we don't yet have. Necessary, but they really need a push at the very beginning of the development chain in terms of R&D. I think it's important to recognize we need all three of these. A lot of the time when people talk about the technology, they tend to focus perhaps on the third one, because it's really both exciting to think about there being a great new technology out there, and also easy to think about this being something we still need to work on and then it will all be solved with one technology. Sometimes you'll hear people focusing only on the second one. That's also a bit misleading. It's great that these things are showing positive trends, but they're not enough alone. And people may also focus quite a lot on the first one, as if they're coming to this for the first time. Well, energy efficiency, that makes sense. In a way, that's one of the most challenging. We have these technologies for ages, and no one's been able to crack a good business model for rolling out efficiency technology. So they're all important. Briefly, just diving into them one at a time, we've got energy efficiency technologies, as I mentioned. These are mostly proven, and they're not particularly exciting looking, right? You see the kind of excitement that the latest release of the Tesla car gets. To be honest, the latest release of the latest type of insulation doesn't, like, drive that kind of excitement, okay? But actually, it can deliver significant change, and it can produce a very high quality change in your standard of life, the cost that you have of energy to your home and also to commercial buildings and operations. Also, what's important if we adopt efficiency is that it reduces the cost of the rest of the things we're doing because you don't need to produce as much heat and you don't need to produce as much electricity. It makes a lot of sense, but there's a lot of issues with having full disclosure of information, people's lack of knowledge about the right technologies, and a lack of access to the upfront capital that people need to make those investments, even though they might pay back over the time of your asset, be that a commercial building or a household and so on. So a real challenge there. What about technology showing positive trends? Well, you'll hear a lot about the rapid growth in renewables in recent years. So if you look at the graph this way, it's actually really quite phenomenal, quite a rapid growth. If you look at that same chart shown as percentage of total power supply, then it will look very, very small and maybe a little bit depressing. So there's a rapid change, phenomenal, actually you could even say to some degree exponential, but again, it still needs a push and it needs the right kind of rules around planning and so on, even if not necessarily a payment for feed-in tariffs, but in some cases, perhaps financial support. Here's another area that's showing a lot of promise. So we've seen this rapid drop in solar technology costs, which has led to the graph I showed previously, and a lot of people are predicting and projecting and hoping that we'll see similar cost reductions for energy storage techniques, which will help work together with intermittent supplies of like renewable energy in a way that can also help us reduce the carbon intensity of our energy supply and perhaps our heating supply if we decide to electrify it, and perhaps transport if we decide to electrify it. So these are really promising technologies. And what about the technologies that are necessary but require R&D? So this is when we get all excited, right? This is the kind of sexy stuff. Why is it important? Where are we seeing the real gaps? So this is a breakdown of the carbon dioxide emissions by sector in 2070, if we want to stay below 2 degrees C. So some colleagues of mine do a lot of energy projections, and they can break that down into the kind of mix that we need. Where would the remaining emissions need to come from? Okay, so there are some places that are really difficult to decarbonize. The industry sector, there are parts of the industry sector that are impossible to decarbonize at the moment. A lot of that is industry process emissions. So inevitable carbon dioxide emissions, for example, that come from chemical processes. Similarly, there's some anticipated continued emissions from electricity and upstream energy processing. Aviation is a very difficult nut to crack, and agriculture as well. What does that mean? Well, you'll see that there's some shaded coloring on the blue bar and the red bar that are below zero. That's a little bit strange. What's that? What's that all about? Well, that's the unknown technology that will deliver emissions reductions and help us take greenhouse gases out of the environment. As someone said earlier in a meeting I was in earlier, formerly known as trees. So obviously there are trees, but we're talking about doing something rapidly and on a scale that we haven't seen before and without using up all the land that we actually need to use to grow food for the 9 billion people that will also be demanding these services. So what kind of technologies are going to help us decarbonize in a world where we still expect emissions from these sectors? And here are some of them. Carbon capture and storage. That's obviously an area where the expertise you have in Alberta could be phenomenally important, and it could also help you make good use of the hydrocarbons that you have already. We need to look at advanced industrial processes, perhaps even replacing some of the materials that we use now so that we can reduce emissions as far as possible in heavy industry. Or find solutions to providing the energy that we need at great intensity for industrial processes. As I mentioned, we need negative emissions technologies that do not exist at the moment. Some of those might be bioenergy coupled with CCS, but that's wholly untested and fully reliant on the sustainability of the supply of bioenergy that goes in, and also a lot of land. And then there's hydrogen planes. So I look forward to flying in one of those. And there are people thinking about developing these technologies, but they're really far out. They're really far out there, but yet essential. So I just quickly want to spend a few more minutes before I wrap up on thinking about how we might support those kind of things. One of the things that we do at Imperial College in London is we run an acceleration program particularly for climate change. So we run an accelerator program to help people develop ideas from the very early stages of a first idea in academia to developing it to the very beginnings of a startup. And what we do is we provide education for the next generation of entrepreneurs, teaching people who are engineers what it also feels like to start your own business and how you would do that, and encouraging people to become entrepreneurial and innovative. And then we also try and help them create those businesses so that they can scale up and maybe deliver some of those things. These businesses are working across all three of those technology categories. So developing business models for existing technology, working with technology we've seen ramping up, and also trying to develop even new technology. See, these are the kind of things we do. We have, you know, all these great words that are kind of in a way new to me. We have hack spaces and ideathons and hackathons and all of these great things. It basically means bringing people together, bringing a combination of students that have enthusiasm, of early career engineers that have ideas, people from the finance sector and experienced business people who have started up their own startups and can offer mentorship. We provide grant funding to people at the earliest stages of their businesses, and we also provide social capital, i.e. networks and mentoring to help people get their businesses together. And those are the kind of things that can take this challenge, combine it with the human capital that Maria was talking about, and help deliver an ecosystem for change and innovation. So here are the kind of things that I'd like you to think about to help make this change happen. First of all, everyday decision making happens. It matters to making these changes happen and encouraging all of those technologies to roll out and be developed. Energy efficiency, I'm very keen on saying this because I really hope that one day someone will solve this challenge of making energy efficiency attractive. The growth in clean technologies give huge, huge opportunities, but of course can be quite disruptive to the current energy system. It needs to be supported by smart and flexible grid systems, not necessarily at the significant, at a particularly significant cost. So studies at Imperial show those costs can be around 15 pounds per megawatt hour, and maybe only a little bit more than that at higher levels of renewable penetration. But you need to have a development of the supportive grid technology at the same time to help manage that transition. Support is needed to scale up technologies as well as that R&D stage. So as I said, we can get very excited about wanting to fund R&D. That seems like an obvious no-brainer. Research makes sense, especially sitting here in a university. But you do also need support to take things to the next stage once you have a product developed to make sure that you can deploy it. And again, CCS is one of those technologies that needs a test in a deployment context. As I said, technology innovation is still needed though. So we're not waiting for a silver bullet, but there are some areas where we definitely need more ideas. And this is something exactly what Maria said, investment is important. So you want to make all of these ideas investable for people out there, particularly as we see some investors starting to look for investments that they can say, yeah, this is a good green investment. This is an investment that tackles climate change. They need to have people out there creating projects that are investable. And I know, having spoken to people at the European Investment Bank, for example, they have quite a strong level. A very high percentage of their investments have to be in something that meets very, very stringent environmental targets. They actually struggle to find investable projects. So, you know, be the one providing those investable projects. I'm going to finish also with a quote. The quote is from someone who works in investment, actually. And she tried to remind people that if you're not doing something that's investing in or trying to make a lower carbon world happen, then you might actually think about it differently. You're actually deciding to create a world where we have a high degree of temperature change. You're making that choice. So I'm encouraging you to make the choice to help create a lower carbon world where there's less disruptive impact, you know, on the world through a changing climate and really positive change and achievable transition.